Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The first portfolio is rural affairs and islands. I remind members that questions 3 and 7 are grouped together, so I'll take any supplementaries on those questions after both have been answered. And if members wish to ask a supplementary on any of the other questions, I'd invite them to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. I can advise the Chamber there is a considerable amount of interest in asking supplementaries. Therefore, the usual plea of brief questions and brief answers. And if they aren't brief, I will be cutting you off. So be warned. Question number one is Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government when it will publish the final details of its proposed agricultural bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is committed to introducing a new agriculture bill to the Parliament in 2023. A public consultation on the bill seeking views on proposals to assist in delivering the vision for agriculture and a legislative framework required to replace the current Common Agricultural Policy from 2025-26 onwards closed on the 5th of December. So we are now carefully considering the diverse range of views provided and aim to publish those responses in the spring.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Minister for that response and note that information is being both gathered and emerging in stages, but what's important is that any scheme is sufficiently robust so as to give confidence to food producers. Will the conditionality measures proposed allow for this confidence to be maintained?
Cabinet Secretary.
I know our farmers and crofters want more of that detail and that clarity, and I'd made an announcement on the 10th of February about the publication of a route map, and as well as publishing a list of measures on where our thinking is currently at on new measures for the new framework, which I hope does give some of that confidence that the member's asking for, as well as that additional clarity. Now, while the route map doesn't yet answer all the questions that I know there are, it does provide a clear set of programme dates to explain when current schemes will transition or end and when more information will become available. And it also sets out the framework diagrams which were first published as part of the Agriculture Bill consultation that outline what that future support will look like. In particular, that it's the base tier of support which is aimed at providing financial certainty for farmers and crofters who are engaged in food production and actively managing land. And as we transition to the future, I just want to reiterate my previous commitments that there will be no cliff edges when it comes to support, and we will continue to develop the details of that future support with our farmers and crofters.
And briefly, Rachel Hamilton.
Cabinet Secretary, in committee this morning, we heard from stakeholders from the agricultural sector who actually used those words, they don't want to go off a cliff edge. So I think farmers want clarity, they want to have confidence to go forward with this new agricultural payment plan. Whilst there is a route map, I believe that farmers want to have a seat at the table. They want to have engagement with the Cabinet Secretary, with the Scottish Government. And so will the Cabinet Secretary commit to do that, to give farmers confidence to move forward with their plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
Absolutely. I'm more than happy to do that. And I think that that's where the process that we're taking forward is really important. I know people are desperate for more of that detail and more of the clarity. As I said in my first response, I do hope what we've published gives more of that information. But what is really fundamental to our whole approach is that co-development, that co-design and that discussion with farmers and crofters, because when we implement new measures, I absolutely want to make sure that we get those measures right and that they actually work and can be implemented well. So I'm more than happy to commit to that engagement. We do, although we have the Agricultural Reform Implementation and Oversight Board, which is key in helping us design some of that. I know there are other stakeholder groups there that we want to get involved with that conversation. And of course, I'm happy to get out and about and engage with farmers and crofters directly.
Question number two, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues and councils regarding improving connectivity for Scotland's islands.
Cabinet Secretary.
As Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, I'm responsible for ensuring that cross-government coordination on islands, and I regularly engage with my ministerial and local authority colleagues. A key forum for those discussions is the Island Strategic Group, which brings together ministers and the leaders and chief executives of the island local authorities.
Graeme Simpson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. She'll be well aware of the Orkney Islands Ferries Task Force, and as Islands Minister, I hope she's involved with that. So what can she say to provide reassurance that this will not be yet another talking shop and that it will lead to tangible results, i.e. new ferries?
Cabinet Secretary.
The member will, of course, be aware that it's the Deputy First Minister who's involved with that task force. I don't think anybody would want that to be a talking shop and wants that to lead to actual action. So I don't think it's fair to necessarily write that off at the moment. So I know that the last meeting was on the 31st of January, but of course I'm happy to take that up with the Deputy First Minister and provide a further update on that work.
I have a number of supplementaries. They will have to be brief, as will the answers. First, Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yet again, we've got ferry chaos on the Western Isles. The relief ferry serving South Euston Barra has technical issues, so it can only sail in daylight. And even with stretching days, that places a huge restriction on its operation. This was a relief ferry, and Euston is already facing disruption due to the UEG pier closures. Can the Cabinet Secretary say what she is doing to mitigate the impacts of this ferry chaos on islanders who cannot plan, cannot work, cannot socialise without
Cabinet
allowing
Secretary.
Several
Cabinet
days
Secretary.
To be I absolutely recognise how critical these links are, and I'm sure the member will have already raised these points with the Transport Minister, but I'm more than happy again to do that on her behalf and come back with a response to her specific queries.
Fiona Hislop.
We heard from Island Councils in a recent Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee meeting that Transport Scotland only engaged with councils on their own predetermined agenda, which hasn't to date included fixed link or tunnel connections for islands. And as some of these councils want to seriously engage on the potential of these, can she discuss with her ministerial colleagues how they might ensure full and proper engagement of Transport Scotland, even simply on initial assessments of what might be possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm more than happy to engage with my ministerial colleagues on that, but from what I believe, Transport Scotland did engage with local authorities on the subject of fixed links as part of the second strategic transport projects review, and all local authorities had responded to the consultation that accompanied that draft publication in January last year. But again, I'm more than happy to take that up with my colleagues and follow up.
And briefly, Beatrice with her.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Tunnels would greatly improve economic and social connectivity in Shetland, and it wouldn't be subject to closure due to adverse weather conditions. When will the Scottish Government sit down with local action groups, councillors and officials to seriously consider feasibility studies for short tunnels in Shetland?
And Cabinet Secretary.
Again, that's a point I'm more than happy to raise with my colleague, the Minister for Transport, to see how any discussion on that could be taken forward, and a follow-up with the member.
Thank you. Question number three, Sian Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the potential impact on the drink industry supply chain on the introduction of the deposit return scheme.
Minister Lorna Slater.
I have kept ministerial colleagues updated with developments during the implementation process. Most recently, I sent a letter to all MSPs earlier this month that provided a comprehensive update ahead of the launch of the UK's first deposit return scheme. I will continue to keep Parliament up to date as we head towards the go-live date in August of this year.
Sian Dowie, could you adjust your microphone just slightly?
Thank you. Having spoken to rural businesses, they have raised concerns about the 24 substantial steps required to register for the deposit return scheme. The first step requires a business to sign up to a three-year legal commitment, which will significantly change their operations and could even bankrupt them. If businesses fail to sign up by next week, the risk that they may no longer be able to sell in Scotland could significantly impact the rural supply chain. Will the Minister engage with these businesses to limit the impact on the rural supply chain and speak to her Cabinet colleagues to listen to and address these concerns?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for the questions. The concerns raised by small producers I am taking very, very seriously, as the member will note from the significant intervention for small producers, well, for all producers, but focused on small producers' needs that was announced on Tuesday this week, increased cash flow and simplification of labelling for small quantities. I'm going to meet again with small producers tomorrow to see what else we can put on the table to help them to comply, and I would to comply with the legislation, and I would encourage all producers to begin their registration process with Circularity Scotland by the deadline of the end of this month.
Question 7, Jamie Green.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding the potential impact of the deposit return scheme on small-scale drinks producers.
Minister.
As I confirmed in my response to Sharon Dowie, I have kept ministerial colleagues updated with developments during the implementation process. The letter that I sent to all MSPs earlier this month details measures we have put in place to support businesses, including small producers. I will continue to listen to the concerns of small producers and whether there is any further action we can take to support them ahead of the scheme going live.
Jamie Green.
Well, as part of that listening exercise, could the Minister listen to this? This is Philip Sisson, who runs Simple Things Fermentations, a small craft brewery in Glasgow. He's written to me today, and he wants me to say this to the Minister. TRS will have a catastrophic impact on my business and the craft sector. We survived the pandemic by producing quality products and offering excellent service, but that won't be enough to get us through the chaotic implementation of a badly flawed DRS. He says small producers are being thrown under the bus. Minister, is he wrong?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for the question. I met with small producers a week ago on Friday in which we discussed their concerns in great detail, including their specific concerns around cash flow for their businesses and the costs around labelling of small quantities. The Circularity Scotland announced an intervention on Tuesday, £22 million worth of support for the cash flow of small businesses and a solution for labelling to specifically support craft brewers, small wine importers and craft spirit producers. This was a significant intervention to support these businesses, and I look forward to meeting those businesses tomorrow again to find out if there's anything further we can do to support them to participate in the scheme.
And a number of supplementaries, same appeal, brief questions, brief answers. First, Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I must agree with Jamie Green here. I've been written to by Traquair Brewery, my constituency, famous for its craft brews, operating since 1965, with a global reputation exporting all around the world. All materials sourced locally, even the malt is put into cattle feed. They tell me, without anything else, that the deposit return scheme will have a devastating effect on their business in all respects. Now, I hear what the
Question,
Minister says,
please,
but
Graham.
Will the Minister please listen to these small craft breweries?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for the question. I take the considerations and concerns of small businesses very seriously. That is why I met with them a week ago Friday, and we have put this week a significant intervention. Circularity Scotland has announced £22 million of cash flow support and specific response to their concerns around labelling. These were the issues that were raised with me by small business, and this was the solution put into place by Circularity Scotland. I will meet with these businesses again tomorrow to take forward any further concerns.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, President. Also, the Minister will know that a Scotland-wide tender was issued to American hedge fund-owned Biffa to provide collections under the scheme. What assessment has the Minister made of the impact this may have on the small and medium-sized businesses in rural communities who were excluded from that decision and, in some cases, will actually lose existing contracts for recycling collections?
Minister.
I thank the member very much for the question. Circularity Scotland is a private business, and therefore their procurement processes are for them. It's not a government procurement process, and they may conduct those how they wish to do. When the deposit return scheme comes online, the amount of glass and other recyclate in the system that is collected and cleaned for recycling will increase enormously. Curbside recycling and other systems will still deal with non-scheme articles, so your pasta jars, your other things, shampoo bottles, all these materials will still be in the standard recycling schemes. The deposit return scheme specifically increases the volume and quality of recycling of scheme materials, which overall will increase our recycling in Scotland.
Mr. Lumsden, please, no more heckling from a sitting position. Colette Stevenson, briefly.
Can the Minister outline the discussions Scottish Government and drinks producers have had, and will these continue, particularly with small businesses, to ensure the rollout is a success?
Briefly as possible, Minister.
Thank you very much. As I've outlined to other colleagues, I am taking a pragmatic approach on the implementation of DRS and am regularly meeting with industry stakeholders, including drinks producers, to get direct feedback on the scheme and to identify challenges and solutions. As a result of industry feedback, particularly from small businesses like craft breweries, Circularity Scotland announced a £22 million package of support for these producers. I will continue to engage with businesses, and indeed tomorrow I'll be meeting with small drinks producers again to discuss their readiness for launch.
Question number four, Kenny Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government, in relation to its cross-government coordination on island policies, what discussions the Rural Affairs Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding any impact on rural and island communities of the closure of outdoor education centres?
Cabinet Secretary.
Ministers and officials across portfolios are aware of and consider the important role that outdoor centres have in rural and island communities. Outdoor centres can provide educational experiences, create employment and volunteering opportunities, and support connections into the wider rural economy. Such considerations were a key element of decisions to provide £4 million in tailored emergency financial support to outdoor education centres during the COVID-19 pandemic.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Welcome news is that the Arran Outdoor Education Centre has been saved from possible closure by North Ayrshire Council's SNP administration. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that it's important to provide long-term guarantees regarding retention of such facilities, and that the staff, parents and young people who strongly value such unique resources deserve to know that each year they will not have to worry about potential closure?
Cabinet Secretary.
I know that this would be a concerning time, and as the member raises the decisions that are taken on an annual basis. Now, it isn't for Scottish ministers to intervene in local authority spending decisions. Councils are autonomous, and it's their responsibility to agree their annual budgets, taking into account their statutory duties as well as other national and local priorities too. And of course, they're accountable to the public who elect them and have the financial freedom to operate independently while taking account of local need. But of course, I would encourage North Ayrshire to consider staff and service users in the decisions that they are making, as I'm sure that they do at the moment.
Question number five, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the steps that it is taking to improve the management of inshore fisheries in light of the reported increasing pressures on fishers and fish stocks in Scotland's coastal regions.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland's fisheries management strategy sets out the Scottish Government approach to sustainable and responsible sea fisheries management in Scotland. A delivery plan was published in September last year, setting out how and when we would deliver the range of actions in the strategy. There is a clear signal on front-loading actions which would deliver enhanced environmental benefits and significant improvements to our fisheries management approach, including inshore fisheries. And this contains a mix of actions from the strategy alongside the commitments in the Bute House Agreement. And these will all be delivered in partnership with our stakeholders.
Gillian Mackay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. It is heartening to note the commitment to place the Fisheries Management and Conservation Group on a more strategic footing. Given the importance of the inshore region for both livelihoods and biodiversity, what plans does the Scottish Government have to develop ecosystem-based inshore fisheries management plans, including spatial or temporal management measures, to help achieve our legal duty of managing our seas to good environmental status, and what are the timescales for this work?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Member has quite rightly outlined our legal obligations as set out in the Joint Fisheries Statement and the types of approaches that have been set out within that. Now, in our response and in that document, what we've talked about and what we've committed to across the UK is the overarching strategy that we can all sign up to, which also provides us with the flexibility and also recognises the devolved responsibilities within each of these areas. So the fisheries and management strategy that I talked about is critical in relation to that, as are a number of pieces of work that we're currently taking forward to. So the member talked about the refresh of the FMAC that has been undertaken. We've also been looking at the role of our regional inshore fisheries groups, as well as a number of pieces of work looking at our future catching policy. We've had the consultation on REM technology too, as well as looking at other measures in relation to inshore fisheries. So I hope that offers some assurance in terms of the work that we're taking forward that ultimately will meet these objectives.
I won't get all the supplementaries in. We'll get as many as I can. First, Finlay Carson.
Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with her Green Coalition partner, Ariane Burgess, that fish stocks around Shetland are in rapid decline as a result of destructive methods of inshore fishing? Or does she instead agree with the Shetland Fishermen's Association's well-evidenced response that her comments are ignorant of the fact that Shetland's inshore waters still teem with the same fish and shellfish stocks that have helped sustain their community for generations as a result of sustainable fishing practice?
Cabinet Secretary.
And sustainable fishing practices are exactly what we want to see. I mean, a key part of my role is going out and about, visiting our islands, speaking to our fishers, speaking to our farmers as well. But I know people greatly care about the environment in which they operate. And again, the measures that I outlined in my initial response to Gillian Mackay, I think, outline the work that we're taking forward, why that's so important, the objectives that were set out in the Joint Fisheries Statement as well. I mean, we're legally obliged to ensure that we adhere to those, which is why the measures we're proposing are so important. But again, with all this work that we're taking forward, it's engaging with our fishers, with our stakeholders, is critical in all of that work, because again, it's within all of our best interests to ensure that we have a healthy marine environment with healthy fish stocks, so that we continue, so that we have our fishers and that industry going forward into the future, providing that valuable food source
for
us.
Very briefly, Alistair Allen.
The government has already committed to introducing legislation to make REM and scallop dredge vessels and pelagic vessels mandatory. But does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that during a period where there will likely be changes how we interact with the marine environment, we must ensure that fishers are absolutely recognised for the value of the role that they play?
Very briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Oh, just to say that I absolutely could not agree more with the point that the member has raised, because we recognise the absolutely vital role that fishing plays in our economy, how many jobs it supports in our coastal communities, as well as contributing to Scotland's hugely successful food and drink sector. Quality Scottish seafood is prized right around the world, and we'll continue to do all that we can to support the industry.
Thank you. Question number six, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on avian flu in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Since the start of October last year, there have been 21 confirmed cases of highly pathogenic avian influenza H5N1 in poultry and captive birds, and 107 findings in wild birds in Scotland. We continue to monitor the number of cases in poultry and wild birds, and the latest evidence suggests that we're beginning to see a decrease in the rate of cases across GB. In response to this decrease, we've adjusted the reporting thresholds for surveillance in wild birds to support the ongoing monitoring of levels of the disease circulating in wild species.
Alexander Burnett.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. We now know that avian flu can be transferred to seals after four Scottish seal carcasses tested positive for the virus earlier this month, one of which was found dead in Aberdeenshire in 2021. So can the Cabinet Secretary confirm when she first learned about the transfer of avian flu to seals and outline what action she has taken to mitigate the impact of this?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the first point that I would want to make in relation to that is that the risk to human health from the virus is low, and Food Standards Scotland advises that avian influenza poses a very low food safety risk for people who consume poultry products, including eggs. Now, in relation to what the member has talked about there and what we're seeing in cases of other mammals, samples taken as part of routine wildlife surveillance last year have detected the presence of avian influenza in four otters and four seals from Scotland, as well as five red foxes from England and Wales. Now, these animals were found in areas with high incidence of H5N1 in wild bird populations, and of course scavenging on wild birds is thought to have been the source of infection, but the detection of that virus doesn't mean that it was the cause of death of these animals. We know that wild birds and animals can carry several diseases that can be transmitted to people, so people shouldn't touch or pick up any dead or visibly sick birds. But I know that this is of concern, but the risk that we're associating with this is still considered to be extremely low, so I would just want to offer the assurances on that front. But again, with this, we have our Chief Veterinary Officer, our animal health teams who are working flat out on this issue, who are continuing that surveillance and to see what action, if any, can be taken to try and stop its spread.
Very, very brief supplementaries first, Ariane Bird.
Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary when the response plan for wild birds will be published and if it will contain tangible measures for protecting and conserving wild birds and on carcass collection during the HPAI outbreak?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, just to say that the response plan is still under development, but I'd be happy to follow up with the member and hopefully provide a more indicative timescale.
And very briefly, Evelyn Tweed.
In light of avian flu being discovered in Stirling last week, can the Minister briefly outline the biodiversity steps people can take to reduce the spread of this disease?
I doubt you'll be able to outline them, Cabinet Secretary, but as briefly as possible.
Oh, just to say that, I do think that it's really important to highlight and remember that it's the biosecurity measures that are absolutely critical and offer the best protection against the spread of this disease. And that can, some of these measures can include things like cleaning and disinfecting clothes and footwear and equipment, and in reducing the movement of people and vehicles, and also preventing that contact with wild birds. These are just some of the measures. But again, I think it's really important that people take their biosecurity seriously.
And question number eight, Daniel Jones.
To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to support local independent food and drink businesses in rural areas.
Cabinet Secretary.
We're providing a broad range of measures that help support local independent food and drink businesses in rural areas. So this includes £15 million of funding towards the Scotland Food and Drink Recovery Plan over 2020 to 2023, £17.5 million to businesses across Scotland over the last 2 years through the Food Processing, Marketing and Cooperation Grant Scheme, and £500,000 towards the Scottish Grocers Federation Go Local programme, which we know has helped many independent convenience operators in rural areas transform their stores and stock more locally sourced produce.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for that answer, but all of that will be for naught if they don't sort out the deposit return scheme. Because ultimately what small producers and retailers want is simplification of SKU registration and barcodes. They want an opt-in possibility. They want the removal of the arbitrary and hard deadline that's coming up. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if she's had a formal meeting with Lorna Slater to discuss those options, and when was that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course I discuss these matters with my ministerial colleagues, given the impact that there is and the nature of my responsibilities within my own portfolio. Now, the Minister has outlined today already in the responses that she's given to previous questions to some of the measures that have been introduced, which I think are really important. And the Minister has, of course, been engaging with a whole wide variety of businesses impacted by DRS, taking those concerns on board. And, of course, there is the debate covering this item this afternoon too. So the Minister is listening and is taking action.
Thank you very much. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause before we move on to the next portfolio. The next portfolio is health and social care questions. I'd remind members that question 1 and 3 are grouped together, and I'll take supplementaries on those questions after both have been answered. Anyone seeking a supplementary on any other questions should press the request to speak button during the relevant question. The same appeal, there again considerable interest in supplementaries. If you do get invited to ask a question, keep it brief. Similarly, the responses from the ministerial team brief as well. Question number 1, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to increase the number of student nurses.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has increased nursing student numbers every year for the last 10 years, but we know, of course, that the undergraduate programme is not the only solution to increasing the numbers of nurses into our NHS and indeed into other sectors too. That's why we're working with partners to widen access to these vital nursing programmes. We now have an education and development framework for the NHS, bands 2 to 4 healthcare support workers, which will allow them to develop within the scope of their role to support the registered workforce and also, importantly, to achieve progression within the job family. At the same time, we're also exploring how to expand options for our healthcare support workers to continue to enter programmes on an earn-as-you-learn basis, as well as access programmes for undergraduate nursing degrees.
Sue Webber.
Thank you for that response. UCAS have reported that applications to study nursing in Scotland were down 24% this year, with just over 5,000 applicants. There are over 4,500 vacancies in nursing, and importantly, over 2,500 nurses have left the profession in the 12 months to September 2022. The Scottish Government's announcement of a ministerial-led nursing task force is welcome news. However, any recommendations from that are some long way off. And it's clear recruiting student numbers in Scotland, and there is a need... However, it is clear student nursing numbers in Scotland are in crisis. What immediate action is the Cabinet Secretary taking to reverse this trend?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Sue Webber for what I think is a really important question. She's right, the level of vacancies are not where we would want them to be, to put it mildly, and that's why the Nursing Task Force, Nursing and Midwifery Task Force, I should make that point, is exceptionally important. And that came out of a discussion with the RCN, with the RCM and indeed other trade union partners too. What I would say to Sue Webber, notwithstanding the point that she correctly makes about the numbers being 24% down, remember recruitment
recruitment to nursing programmes will continue until June, so we'd expect that number to increase as we get towards June. What I'll also do is make sure that I update Ms Weber in writing, perhaps given the need for brevity, on how we are doing in relation to international recruitment. And let me just put it make it very clear that I think with the Nursing and Midwifery Task Force is a real opportunity to widen access and entry into nursing, and hopefully by the good work we're doing on pay, that will help to retain and make the exit door out of nursing very narrow indeed.
Question number three, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to ensure that the number of applicants applying to study nursing in Scotland does not drop further in the future, especially in light of UCAS data reportedly showing that the number of applicants has fallen by 24% compared to the same point last year.
Cabinet Secretary.
And can be relatively brief, because obviously I've answered some of that question in the last response. What I would say is that Colin Beattie will hopefully be reassured that higher education institutes will continue to recruit to the programmes until June. So we'd always expect there to be an increase in the numbers between the figures released in January and the figures at the in June. What I would also say is that not all funded places are applied for via UCAS. Again, something I think Colin Beattie will undoubtedly know. For example, Open University funded places, and those applications will also contribute to final student numbers. Lastly, I'd say that the pay offer that we have put on the table for 23-24 will ensure that our nurses, as well as other NHS Agenda for Change staff, remain the best paid in the entire UK. And I think that's a great draw to get those people, those individuals, working in the NHS.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. It's important to ensure that we have provision for the future workforce of nurses for our health service, and that we encourage applicants to study nursing in Scotland. With this in mind, Scotland has seen a 5% increase in nursing and midwifery acceptance student numbers since 2019. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline the steps being taken to encourage applicants and confirm that we are recruiting at the level the country needs?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks to Colin Beattie for that question. I would, I suppose, reiterate what I said to Sue Webber. The level of vacancy is not, we would not like to see. We want to reduce that level of vacancy as much as we possibly can. And our nurses, of course, make up the largest profession in our NHS. I'm proud that we've increased our funded nursing places for 10 consecutive years. But we're now very much actively working on that widening access to nursing programmes. I go back to a point made in the previous question that these recommendations of a nursing task force may take some time. Actually, we're looking for some really quick wins. I think there are some quick wins that we can make to widen that access very much into the profession. So I will keep members that are interested updated on the work of that task force.
Got a number of supplementaries. They'll need to be brief. Likewise, the responses. First, Jackie Bailey.
The 24% reduction in the number of nurses applying is, of course, the biggest drop in applicants for nursing in any part of the UK and the lowest figure at any point in the last 5 years. With 6,300 nursing vacancies in Scotland, the reduction in numbers applying will add to the workforce crisis. Others have asked what he intends to do to boost recruitment. Let me focus on the short term. Because will the Cabinet Secretary bring forward a retention strategy to stop nurses who are currently leaving in droves because they feel exhausted and burnt out?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say, Jackie Bailey, I think she makes a very reasonable point about the retention side of things, but that is precisely why we've set up the Nursing and Midwifery Task Force. It's there to look at issues of, for example, flexible working. So how many nurses have Jackie Bailey and I probably spoken to who say that they feel the NHS is simply not flexible if they want to change their shift patterns? It will look at, for example, what more we can do in around retention. That will be a key focus of it. So instead of setting up the strategy, I think the right way around to do it is to engage with the RCA and other trade unions, employers, engage with the staff, hear from them directly about the suggestions they want to see, and try to get some quick wins. So I don't think there's much between us. I can't quite hear Jackie Bailey as she shouts from a sedentary position.
Please ignore the sedentary intervention.
Happy to pick up with her after
Sandy Scrohan.
Thank you. The Royal College of Nurses exposes the crisis in nursing by underscoring the significant risk to patient care, with 9 in 10 nurses, almost 86%, reporting their last shift was unsafe for them and their care of their patients. We cannot afford a nursing task force to only be a talking shop. With me likely addressing our new First Minister,
question,
will he please,
please
outline how he will improve safety for patients and for nurses?
Cabinet Secretary.
I might not be putting that on my endorsement leaflet, but thank you for the offer. What I would say to Sandish Gohani is what definitely would not help us is the approach that the UK government has taken, which is not to meaningfully engage with nurses, and then they go on strike, they feel that they're devalued. We are taking a different approach. We're engaging meaningfully with our nurses, we've avoided dispute, we've avoided strike, and here we are making sure that they are the best remain, the best paid nurses anywhere in the UK. So we'll continue to engage with our nurses. It won't be a talking shop. I'm surprised he describes the RCN as a talking shop. They are going to be integral members of that nursing task force, and they have welcomed it. In fact, the nursing task force idea from the RCN.
Cabinet Secretary, ask for brief responses as well. Brief supplementary, Paul McLennan.
Thank you. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree the UK Government should match the 10,000 non-means-tested bursary that students get in Scotland to attract nurses to the sector across the UK? And does he agree with me that the UK Government were to match the pay deals being offered to nurses in Scotland, they need to increase the nurse pay by 14%?
Cabinet Secretary.
I don't know why the Conservatives are moaning about this. They ask about recruitment and retention. This is fundamental. I agree that other governments should look to what we're doing in Scotland so that nurses don't start their lives in debt. With our pay offer, an experienced nurse will earn £37,664 compared to, in England, £32,934, a 14% difference. So, yes, we should make sure that we don't only reward nurses as best as we possibly can, but make sure those who are training to be nurses get all the support they possibly
Question
can.
Question 2, Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I refer to my register of interest as a member of the GMB and Unite Trade Unions to ask the Scottish Government what its response is to trade unions and charities forming a coalition of concern to request that the National Care Service Scotland Bill is paused to allow further co-design and consultation.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Presiding Officer, I declare an interest as a member of Unison. We remain committed to the bill. People with direct experience of social care and community health care have repeatedly told us that the system needs to change. We must end the postcode lottery and drive up standards across Scotland. And I welcome the engagement that trade unions and charities have had to date, and I strongly encourage the third sector, councils, the workforce, charities, unions and people to engage in the co-design process.
Monica Lennon.
Thank you. Minister, the response from Civic Society, Civic Scotland, is catastrophic. It's not engagement we need. It's a minister and a government that will listen. The list includes the STUC, Unite, GMB, Unison, Who Cares, Parkinson's UK, Commonweal, and yes, even the SNP trade union group. It cannot be ignored, Minister, and we now have candidates for First Minister saying the bill should be paused. So what work is happening around government tables to listen, to learn from other bills and to pause this? And in terms of valuing the workforce, a 40p pay rise is an insult. What is going to be done to deliver credible pay rise of at least £15 an hour for our hard-working care workers?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are committed to delivering the National Care Service Bill and to deliver by the end of this Parliament. And I continue to listen. And I wish that folk themselves would listen to others who may not share their views. Because earlier on, just before coming into the chamber, I met with the Dementia Lived Experience panel. These people want to see the end of the postcode lottery of care. These folk want to see national high-quality standards, and they want to see the National Care Service. And the National Care Service will allow us to ensure that there is sectoral bargaining over pay and conditions, which will be the case for the first time. 72% of people responding to the consultation wanted a National Care Service. We will deliver that.
Brief supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's really important to recognise the urgent need to make improvements to social care now and not to wait for the NCS to start that process. So with this in mind, can the Minister provide an update on the action being taken now to address challenges in
very
social
briefly,
care?
Very briefly, very briefly.
Presiding Officer, we are taking action now to address challenges in social care. Our manifesto commitment was to increase social care funding by at least £840 million over the Parliament. We are on course to substantially exceed this. And what I would say is that this budget, the budget yesterday, set out £1.1 billion in adult social care support from the health portfolio. The budget, the 23-24 budget, increases social care spending and has increased it by over £800 million to 21-22. That is working in the here and now to improve social care in Scotland.
My apologies to those who I wasn't able to take question for, David Thorne.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to address the waiting well agenda in light of a recent roundtable event on supporting patients that was hosted by Scotland versus Arthritis.
Minister Morito.
The Scottish Government's Preventative and Proactive Care PPC programme is developing a waiting well framework and associated delivery action plan. This will help to improve health and wellbeing outcomes for people waiting for health and social care interventions. A steering group has been set up to steer this work, with the first meeting having taken place on the 21st of February 2023.
David Torrance.
I thank the Minister for the answer. Scotland versus Arthritis six-part support package for people waiting for joint replacement surgery suggests that key elements of support are communication, personalised self-management support, access to physical activity programmes, mental health support, signposting to financial support and advice, and including waiting well support in NHS recovery plan. Does the Scottish Government agree that with this approach, and how much are NHS boards being assessed in the delivery of support for patients?
Minister.
The Versus Arthritis support package was tested by the Golden Jubilee National Hospital around orthopaedic pathways. Following this, a proposal was submitted to the Centre for Sustainable Delivery under planned care improvement, which is now being considered as part of the waiting well workstream within the Preventative and Proactive Care programme. Versus Arthritis are members of the waiting well steering group, and the improvement areas highlighted, such as communication, will be taken forward within that workstream, including monitoring how waiting well is implemented.
A very brief supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you. Under this Health Secretary's watch, we are facing a waiting times crisis. There are stories of people having to fundraise for private surgery rather than wait in pain. So where is the urgency from this government on treatment options in treatment centres, and how is it going to ensure that people have access to meaningful waiting plans that are influenced by a waiting well strategy which is supported by the third sector?
Minister.
So, yet again from my colleague on the Labour benches, there's not a mention or an acknowledgement of the global pandemic that this country and all of the Western world have come through.
Didn't have an impact.
No impact whatsoever. So what we're doing to increase capacity, to improve the situation for people who are waiting for surgery, is investing in national treatment services, four of which will be opening very soon.
Question number five, Ros McCall.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taking to eliminate long waits in A&E departments within NHS Fife.
Cabinet Secretary.
The NHS has experienced, of course, one of the toughest winters in its history. Pandemic backlogs, Brexit-driven staff shortages, increased levels of respiratory viruses, they all coalesce to place significant demand on services this winter. Performance against the four-hour target clearly not where we would want it to be, nor the public would expect it to be. Nevertheless, performance has recovered since that really challenging period in the winter peak. We're now working with NHS Fife to reduce A&E waits through that £50 million collaborative programme, focusing on three key areas for NHS Fife. One is the rapid triage unit in GP referrals, which is now opened. Increased use of discharge lounge to speed up those, that discharge process, which we know is so vital for flow through the hospital, and also the reduction in the length of stay and reduction of borders.
Ros McCall.
Thank you for the answer, but it's too slow. Scottish Conservative colleagues recently met with a group of constituents whose loved ones received appalling treatment in Fife. One of those constituents is Trish Nolan. Her husband, John, who's suffering from terminal bladder cancer, was left in a trolley in accident emergency for over 4 hours. No nurses or clinicians came to check on him or gave him any pain relief. John came very close to dying of sepsis that day. Will the Cabinet Secretary apologise to John Nolan for his A&E treatment? And will he, at the very least, agree to meet with families who have actually lost loved ones due to the failure in Fife Health Services?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I absolutely take the opportunity to apologise to anybody, including the Nolan family,
for an unacceptable level of treatment. That's not what I want to see as Health Secretary, and I'm pleased that Ros McCall and other members are raising these cases in the Chamber. I do meet with families regularly, as you'd imagine, those that have not had a good service within the Health Service, and I never hesitate to apologise if they have not received the service that I would expect, let alone that they would expect. What I would say is we are seeing some improvements in NHS Fife. I don't know if this was during the peak of the winter peak, which I had mentioned in my opening response, but we have seen, for example, NHS 8-hour waits are almost 75% lower, and the 12-hour waits are almost 100% lower than in the week ending the 1st of January, forgive me, which was the epicentre really of that winter peak. So I'm seeing shoots of improvement. Still need to make more progress, and of course I'll be happy to continue to meet families that have not had the service in the NHS that we would expect.
Well, we've got a couple of supplementaries in, but they'll need to be very brief, as will the responses. First, Alec Riley.
Presiding officer, this week I met with health unions in Fife, and they're very clear that a key factor in the problems they have is the rise in waiting lists for social care in Fife. Does the Cabinet Secretary recognise that? Does he recognise that poor pay, terms and conditions is a key factor in that? And therefore, rather than wasting £1.4 billion setting up a bureaucracy, a centralised bureaucracy, will he put
Cabinet
money
Secretary,
now Cabinet into paying
Secretary.
Care workers
Cabinet
for the
Secretary.
Job?
Look, I think Alex Rowley, for his worth, raised a really important point here. And I will give him hopefully some degree of comfort by letting him know that the statistics that came out in December 2022 show that Fife recorded a total of 118 delays. Now, that's still far higher than Alex Rowley and I would like to see, but it is a decrease from the 131 from the previous month. So we are, again, seeing some level of progress. What I would say is we'll continue to invest in social care. There's been a number of pay rises for social care staff. What I would say is that for the next financial year, for 23-24, we are not spending £1.5 billion on the National Care Service. That would be incorrect to say that. Yeah. So the amount of money that we will be spending on the National Care Service 23-24 may well look to see how we can rebalance that to cut some of that to current spend, but it will be nowhere near in the magnitude as Alex Rowley says.
Briefly, Willie Rennie.
To see what more we can do to support it.
The Royal College of Emergency Medicine of Scotland have been quite clear that these long waits in A&E can result in deaths and harm, as Ros McCall has just highlighted. So has he done an assessment about the impact in Fife of these long waits? 360 people waited over 4 hours in the last week of January. 50 waited over 8 hours. So
Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary.
Issues. Yeah, can I say to him that I don't disagree with the premise of his question, and I know it's something that the Royal College of Emergency Medicine have raised too, that excessively long waits in our A&E means that patients will come to harm. That's why we're focused on reducing. I mentioned not insignificant reductions in both 12-hour and 8-hour waits, specifically in Fife. So it's where our focus is, it's where our target is. I agree with Alex Rowley, the focus from us has to be relentlessly on social care to get the discharges out of the hospital, help with flow through the hospital. But we're still seeing challenges. People are still presenting with higher acuity. We are still seeing the challenges that we know social care faces, and I'll continue to work with the sector to try to find solutions to
Question number six, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it has taken in light of January's Prostate Cancer UK data on regional inequalities in prostate cancer diagnosis.
Minister Morito.
We've noted this Prostate Cancer UK research and we're discussing it with clinical expert groups across NHS Scotland, including the National Cancer Recovery Group. Prostate Cancer UK will host a meeting in the coming weeks with officials and primary and secondary care clinicians in NHS Scotland to further analyse the data and to explore how best to support earlier diagnosis efforts of prostate cancer. We recognise that staging prostate cancer is often complex. However, when we compare survival rates, which is, of course, the most crucial measure for any patient, Scotland's five-year survival rate for prostate cancer is 84.3%, and in fact, that is not significantly different from the other UK nations.
Neil Bibby.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Tragically, Scotland has the worst figures for prostate cancer diagnosis in the UK. Over one in three Scottish men are diagnosed too late for a cure. That figure is just one in eight in the south-east of England. What is more, the west of Scotland performs particularly poorly in terms of prostate cancer waiting times. NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde significantly underperforms other health boards in treatment standards. The Government previously assured us they were investigating these figures. What has been the outcome of the Government's investigation? investigations, and what is the Minister now doing to end the shocking postcode lottery in prostate cancer diagnosis?
Minister.
So I would urge some caution and hopefully offer some reassurance to people who might understandably be concerned about this. It is worth noting that the report itself highlights the risk of overdiagnosis. That's where the diagnosis of a cancer that the person wouldn't otherwise have been aware of and they wouldn't have died from. The use of these tests, like the PSA, which is more used in the rest of the UK, increases the risk of this. As I said, ultimately, the most crucial measure is that of survival, which is similar across the UK, and I hope I can offer some reassurance to the public on that.
Question number 7, Natalie Dawn.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the recommendations in the 2023 series on breastfeeding by The Lancet, which include calls for governments to provide more accurate and timely information about breastfeeding and infant behaviours, an end to any exploitative marketing used by the baby formula milk industry, and more recognition of any economic contribution that breastfeeding makes to society.
Minister Marita.
So, first of all, I would say we welcome the 2023 Lancet series on breastfeeding and will absolutely consider its recommendations in due course. The Scottish Government is committed to supporting breastfeeding as the normal nutrition for babies, and we've invested over £7 million of additional funding over the past 4 years to NHS boards and partners to improve breastfeeding experiences. Globally, it's recognised that breast milk and breastfeeding provide clear health benefits to both mother and baby over infant formula, and we believe every child should get the best nutritional start in life and that families should be able to make fully informed choices on how they feed their baby.
Natalie Dawn.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Part of ensuring that breastfeeding rates are increased is by normalising it in our public spaces, and that is something which the Breastfeeding Friendly Scotland scheme aims to achieve, as well as providing staff and volunteers with key training and knowledge. After raising awareness of the scheme and signing up my own constituency office in Renfrew, take-up of the scheme in Renfrewshire has increased massively from one venue to over 60. But can I ask the Minister how the Government is working with health boards to track national take-up of the scheme, how it will work to improve involvement in areas with low take-up, and what the next steps are to ensure that normalising and increasing support for breastfeeding remains a priority in Scotland?
As briefly as possible, Minister.
So I'd like to thank and commend the member for the work she's done to promote the breastfeeding friendly scheme. We continue to encourage our infant feeding advisers to promote that scheme, and there are over 2,000 venues signed up. We know that to protect, support and promote breastfeeding requires a complex multi-level approach, and the Lancet series sets out recommendations which, where focused action can have an impact at population level, including through regulation on the marketing of infant formula. And we're going to continue to prioritise investment in breastfeeding support and embed the UNICEF UK Baby Friendly Initiative across health board settings.
I'm going to take question number 8, Alistair Allen.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on NHS Western Isles' recruitment of a new permanent GP and hospital doctor for the islands of Barra and Battersea.
Cabinet Secretary.
I understand they'll be going out to recruitment this spring, NHS Western Isles, that is, of course. And NHS Western Isles, as the member will know, had to take on Barra medical practice at short notice, and its priority has been a smooth transition, providing a level of continuity for patients.
Alistair Allen.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his reply. As the Health Secretary is clearly aware, our health services are under a huge amount of pressure, and the use of expensive locums long term, as has been the case in Barra for some time, is not ideal. But connected to this matter, can the Health Secretary confirm when a decision will be taken by the Scottish Government on the healthcare outline business case to allow the proposal for a new home for health and other services in Barra to move to stage 2?
As briefly as possible, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, in the interest of brevity, let me say how important I think the Barra and Battersea campus project is. The outline business case has been reviewed by the NHS Capital Investment Group. The group are considering options at the moment, but again, in the interest of brevity, I will write to the member and I'll look to see what more I can do to speed that process up. But it has to have appropriate consideration, as I know the member understands.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.